join me in the call to worship found in your bulletin. Praise the Lord. Those who honor the Lord and adore God's commandments are truly happy. Blessed, their righteousness stands forever. They shine in the dark for others who do right. They are merciful, compassionate, and righteous. Those who lend generously are good people, as are those who conduct affairs justly. Yes, these sorts of people will never be shaken. The righteous will be remembered forever. They won't be frightened. They are steady, trusting in the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as summer draws to a close and autumn quickly approaches, we ask for your love and guidance on our journey into a new season. We thank you for all of the beautiful blessings that you have brought into our lives and are so grateful to have you with us through good times and bad. May your gift of the Holy Spirit be upon us today as we gather together here with our beloved community in worship. Each week, we remember the Lord's Prayer that Jesus taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The scripture reading for today is Luke chapter 14, verse 1, and then verses 7 through 14, and it can be found on page 849 in your pew Bibles in front of you. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of a leader of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When he noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, "Give this person your place." And then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, "Friend, move up higher." Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, "When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you. For you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." This ends the reading.
My friend. Thank you very much, David. Thank you very much. And Rebecca, thank you for the wonderful accompaniment. At this time, I would like to invite our children up for some time with Sylvia.
I'm so glad you guys came up. This would have been really awkward by myself. So I want to tell you guys a story. I think many of you know I grew up in a very small town where we had only one restaurant. I know, right? Shocking. One restaurant. So after church, can you guys imagine what this restaurant was like? It was actually the one day a week where you had to wait for a table. Because everybody got out of church and everybody went to this restaurant. So we would actually have my grandma during church would be like, Bill, your service is going long. If we don't get there soon, we're not going to get a table. And that was how every Sunday was in Walnut Grove at our church. We all went and had a meal together. That was our ritual. Here at Manhattan Beach, you guys don't have that problem, right? So you don't get to ask for Mark or for Matthew to have a shorter sermon to get to a service, right? You don't get to do that. But what are we doing next week? What's next week? Yeah. A carnival? We're having a-ish. Is there going to be food there, though? Yeah, we're going to have food there, and we're all going to eat together. We're going to have a picnic out there together. So that's something that's a ritual that we do here. Can you guys name some other maybe rituals around food? Yeah, what's one? After every Sunday after church, you eat together and you talk? What else? Is there anything else you guys, what else do you guys do around Thanksgiving? Absolutely, that's a ritual where we get together with our family and we are thankful for things. Yeah, what's another? Christmas. What do you have for Christmas every year? You go to your grandma's house, do you have turkey? You have mashed potatoes? No? You don't know? Okay, yeah. Well, we always have mashed potatoes, and I have a chef for a brother-in-law, so we get beef Wellington. I know, right? So we all have rituals around meals. Well, back in Jesus' time, do you think they also had rituals around meals? Yeah. So in the story today, we hear about one of those rituals, that there is a place of honor at the table. Do you guys have that? You have a place where maybe somebody, a guest, comes to visit maybe and you have them sit there? Yeah, do you guys have? Yeah, like the head of the table? Absolutely. So in the story today, Jesus tells people, rather than going and sitting at the head of table and the place of honor and being told to move back, that instead you move back so that you can be told to maybe get closer to the place of honor. So it's kind of like being in line. Who likes to be first in line? Yeah, no, come on, you guys. I know whenever I say line up, I go, oh, 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 yeah. You all like to be first in line, right? Especially when it comes to getting food. Yeah, oh, yeah, absolutely, right? So this is kind of like Jesus telling you, don't be first in line. Let somebody else be first in line, right? Humble yourself. Maybe go towards the back and let somebody go in front of you. So in the Bible verse, it says, I have to make sure I quote it exactly. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. So next week at the picnic, when we're getting ready to have lunch together, are you guys all going to rush to the front of the line? No, yeah, maybe. Well, maybe you can let somebody else go in front of you. All right, so let's all pray together. Let's close our eyes. All right, repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for our rituals, and thank you for the way you teach us through your sacred stories in the Bible. Help us not to always want to be first, but to humble ourselves. Amen. All right, we're going to go downstairs. We're going to go do Sunday Fun Day.
As we prepare ourselves for a time of prayer together as a congregation, I invite us to take just a few moments in silence to breathe and to center ourselves in this space. As we breathe, let us remember that in the wider world, this week we pray for the people of Benin, the Ivory Coast, and Togo. In our nation, we pray for those who are victims and the families of the victims of the shooting in Texas. We pray for all of those in need that they may have what they need. And we pray for our leaders that they may make decisions motivated by compassion and wisdom. In our community, we pray for Carol Curry's mother, Caroline, for Charlotte, for Steve, and for Darlene. And I invite all of us, if we have a name on our hearts that we'd like to lift with our voice, to do so at this time. We join in an attitude of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come together in your presence, thankful for the many gifts we have received in our lives, grateful for the expressions of your love that surround us, and cognizant of the concerns and the needs of those around us and of ourselves. Draw near in our times of celebration, O God, to bring greater joy into those moments, to remind us that those moments reflect what you wish for each of us. Draw near in our times of trouble as well. Draw near and offer us support, a sense of reassurance, a reminder of our place in your community, a reminder of our worth in your eyes. Oh God, we ask that you throw your arms around all of those who are in need, who are hurting, who are anxious. Offer them healing. Offer them reassurance. Offer them peace. Encourage us to share the love we have received with all whom we encounter, following the example that Jesus set, following your command to love one another. We pray all of this, O God, in your most holy name, in the Spirit of Christ. Amen.
Does anybody remember Mac Davis, the country western singer? He had a TV show in high school, and possibly more than one, but one hit song, and that's how I remember him. The lyrics went something like this: "Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble when you're perfect in every way. I can't wait to look in the mirror because I get better looking each day. To know me is to love me. I must be a heck of a man. Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble, but I'm doing the best that I can." Have you ever known anybody like that? I mean, that's kind of an extreme case. I think there's some, most of us, to want to be the center of attention, to want to be the expert on everything, to want to be the one who's always right, the leader, the one whose plan we're always going to follow. That can be a little difficult to live with for the rest of us sometimes. I know, I've known a few people like that over the years. I remember when I was in college, my best friend was a guy named John. He was very smart, well-read, and conversations with him were fun because sometimes there were things that he would know that I'd never heard of, and that was really cool. And there's sometimes there were things I knew that he hadn't heard of, and that was pretty cool as well. It wasn't like one of us had to be right and the other one had to be wrong. We learned from each other, and that was just kind of a fun part of the friendship. Those conversations could be very long and wide and deep. And we, like a number of people in their college years, figured we'd pretty much figured out all the problems of the world. John had a girlfriend. Her name was Sandy. And it was not as fun talking to her because you couldn't really tell her anything she knew about. In fact, if you told her something you thought she might not know about, she would correct you and tell you what was really the case, because she was an expert in everything. And if you doubted her or wanted to look up what she said and check it, she would just get angry because you were clearly not a good friend to do something like that. I remember once starting to come down with a cold, and she said, "Oh, well, what you need to do is go to the emergency room, get them to give you a shot of penicillin. That'll knock that cold right out." I said, "I don't think antibiotics work like that." And she said, "Well, I'm got a lot more experience in this than you do, and that's what you need to do." And so sometime later, when I went to the doctor for something else, I said, "Do you take antibiotics for a cold?" And the doctor said, "No, of course not." And I mentioned that to her, and she kind of rolled her eyes and said, "Well, these doctors, you know." We have a bit of that in our country right now. People who are experts, doctors, scientists, historians, are often called to task by people who heard the way it really is on the internet. And that can be kind of hard to take. And, you know, it may be for big things, or it may be for small, it may be for some things, or maybe for many things. I know that idea that I have to be right, I have to be in the center of things, can start very young, often does. Hopefully we grow out of it. But I remember my niece, who stayed with us for about 6 months when she was 9. And I remember sitting down and helping her with her homework because she was having trouble with multiplication of 3-digit numbers. And so she started doing it. And I said, "Well, no, you need to carry the 1 here." And she said, "No, you don't." And I said, "Well, yes, you do. You don't know what you're talking about." So I was not able to help her with her homework because she felt she could not trust my opinion. Hers was better. Her name was also Sandy. I'm seeing a pattern. although I've known many people who were not named Sandy who had strong opinions and would not be questioned or challenged on them. It's a difficult thing, and it's what Christian tradition calls the sin of pride. And it can be very unhelpful, put it that way. For little Sandy, man, she got a pretty bad score on her report card for math that time. Ultimately, she got better about listening to other people and became a fine woman. Big Sandy, well, she broke up with my friend and married someone else and started her own church. She figured she was the expert because she'd spent years hanging out in the self-help and New Age sections of the bookstore. And they had a noble idea, she and her husband. They were going to have a church where everyone was welcome and everyone was respected, whether you came from a Christian or a Buddhist or a Jewish or an atheist or a Wiccan or whatever kind of background. You would just come and bring your special knowledge and they would all blend it together. But there was, I noticed, when I was still seeing their newsletter, there was one piece of unwritten doctrine, which was Sandy is always right. You can bring your wisdom, but if it doesn't match up with what she believes, you know, that kind of gets put to the side. I don't think anything ever too bad happened with her church that I know of. I don't think they bought a compound anywhere. But I think it can be kind of dangerous when someone who has a lot of charisma and expresses themselves with that kind of confidence picks up followers who are perfectly willing to accept that, yes, they are the most important person, and yes, they are always right. Or if they're wrong, it's seldom enough that it doesn't really matter. And yes, it's okay to hand over your right to have opinions and make decisions on your own to that person. That can be very, very dangerous. And that's whether it's a religious leader, a political leader, a leader of any kind. We need to beware of people who insist on being right, who insist on being the most important, which is, I think, what Jesus is kind of telling us in our story today. In the scripture, Jesus goes to the home of a Pharisee, and he sees that people are kind of jockeying to get the best seats at the table, so they can talk to the host, so they can be the guest of honor, so they can be seen, so everyone will know how important they are. And he tells them a parable, and he says, you know, when you're invited to the wedding feast, isn't it better to wait and see? You know, just take an ordinary seat and wait and see where the host wants you to be. Because if you go and sit at the head table, you may be very embarrassed when he asks you to sit at the kids' table for Thanksgiving dinner. Don't worry about where you sit. Don't worry about your opinions always going unchallenged. Don't worry about being the most important. Don't give your pride too big a leash, because it can turn on you. Now, you can kind of get that story a little messed up too, because some people hear that and they think, oh, well, if I'm going to be humble, that means I'm nothing. I can't do anything right. I'm the lowest and worst person in the room. Have you ever known someone who did that? There's something called imposter syndrome. And I know about it because I do it sometimes. And that is when you get the conviction that people who think you're smart, good, special, they really don't know what they're talking about. You've got them fooled. You feel like you're an imposter doing something that you've got no business doing. Preaching a sermon and you've got no idea what you're talking about. But everybody is fooled, and so you're okay until they wake up someday and then you're in trouble. I think probably for every person who is the egotist, who believes that they're the best and the most important and always right, there are probably 100 people who think too low of themselves. And honestly, that's not humility either. Humility isn't putting yourself down. In fact, I found this out years ago in the Episcopal Book of Common Prayer. It talks about the 7 deadly sins. And it says the sin of pride is the most dangerous. And the sin of pride, of course, is the person who's so full of themselves and puffed up and kind of lords it over everyone else. But the sin of pride is also the person who says, I'm the lowest and the worst, I ruin everything. Because they're both distorting what their place is in the world. None of us are really the best. None of us are really the worst. We're mostly somewhere in the middle. We might call that ordinary, although I think what Jesus would say is no. The middle is a very special place. Because the middle is the honest place. Humility is about honesty. It is about honestly expressing your ideas and opinions, honestly standing up for those things that you know to be right, but doing that with a sense of self-critique as well as critique of others. Humility is listening with respect. And that is, even if the other person seems completely wrong, seems completely off, seems ignorant or irrational, listen well enough that you can hear what they are really saying so that you can understand them. And understanding them, then you may honestly say, well, I don't think you're right. But it's amazing the difference it makes talking to people when you assume an attitude of respect. When you assume that not only can you be right, but they can be right too. Honesty, humility, is when you run across something and you don't know, instead of pushing your way through with an answer that you just made up, saying, I don't know. I need to find out about that. It's also saying, I was wrong. I thought you were wrong, but it turned out I was wrong, and I want you to know that. Humility is not assuming you're automatically right. It's not assuming that anyone else is automatically wrong. It's listening with an open heart and an open mind, and then doing your best to find the truth and follow it. You don't need to take the seat of honor you find. Take any seat, because God will see you and will know you wherever you are. Don't make assumptions. You probably all know the old saying about assumptions, which I won't repeat. It is hard work to put aside our assumptions. It takes a lifetime to become more humble, more honest in that way. But it's worth the effort because, oh Lord, it's hard to be humble, but we're doing the best that we can.
So I figured I'd give this intro to offertory thing another shot. So there was a minister, new to town, and had been invited right off the bat to speak at a big community banquet. So the minister put together their speech, filled it with lots of good jokes, and delivered it brilliantly. Humility. And as the minister was coming to a conclusion, he noticed that sitting in the audience was a local reporter. The minister realized, oh my gosh, I just gave away all my best jokes, and this reporter is going to write a story about all of that, and I need those jokes for my sermons, for my intro to offertory. I can't have them out there. So the minister went up and talked to the reporter and said, you know, explain the situation, and said, so could you just not include the jokes in the story? The reporter said, sure thing. The minister was a bit surprised when he read the story the next day. When it came to the part, it said, the minister included several jokes in their speech that cannot be published. Right? Good one, huh? You know, what occurs to me is that in this moment, as we think about our offering, it's good to be funny, it's good to be serious, it's good to be whatever, but it doesn't truly matter if we use our best material, because it is what God is doing in our hearts that moves us to give of ourselves and to support the ministries of this church as we seek to make God's vision a reality in our world. And so I invite us to listen to that voice in our hearts as we take this morning's offering. Once again, I would like to say thank you to David for offering your morning. Beautiful, lovely. Thank you. And I'm going to thank Rebecca again as she makes her way up to the organ loft, partially because we want to say thank you because she's doing a wonderful job and we so much like having her here. And as you might guess, to give the opportunity to actually get to the organ loft before the communion hymn time comes. So, yes, let us join together in our prayer of dedication that is printed in your bulletin. O God, through these offerings and the offering of our lives, may your vision of unity for all creation reach out from this faith community into the world around us. May we place all that we have, all that we do, and all that we are in your hands, so that you may use us in your mighty work of reconciling the world. Amen. Thank you. I invite you to be seated at this time. On this Labor Day weekend, we are reminded of the contributions made by those who spoke up for the rights of workers in our nation. There's an important link to our faith in this observance as we recall how all people are invited to take time for Sabbath. We are meant to find time to be refreshed and renewed. As we gather at this table, let us open ourselves to be refreshed, not only by the meal we will share, but by the experience of this community of which we are a part.
This morning we will be partaking in communion by intinction. When you come forward to partake in communion, you'll take a piece of bread, dip it in the cup, and partake. Come forward by the center aisle and return by the side aisles. There are gluten-free crackers with the bread, and we use grape juice so that all may participate.
It is our practice to leave the decision about whether children receive communion to their parents or guardians. For this is not our table. This is Christ's table, and all are welcome at Christ's table.
So friends, come to Christ's table, whole or broken, for you are welcome.
Come to Christ's table, friend or stranger, for you are welcome.
Come to Christ's table, sure or questioning, for you are welcome.
And as we come to Christ's table, we remember the story of how Jesus gathered with his friends around a table on the night he was betrayed. And before the meal, he took bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he shared it with his friends, saying, "This is my body given for you. When you gather, share the bread in remembrance of me."
Later, he took a cup, blessed it, and shared with those gathered, saying, "This is the cup of the renewed covenant. When you gather, share this cup in remembrance of me."
We share the bread, we share the cup, in remembrance of Jesus and in celebration of our community of faith. I invite us to find in our bulletins our prayer of thanksgiving and to join together in this prayer. Gracious God, you invite us to this table to be refreshed. Thank you for this gift of community and for the nourishment we receive for body and spirit. Help us to find the energy to live out our faith in the world. Amen. Now you're up.
Our benediction comes to us from the Unitarian Book of Worship this morning. As we go forth, remember, our first task in approaching another people, another culture, another religion, is to take off our shoes, for the place we are approaching is holy ground. Else we may find ourselves treading on other people's dreams. More seriously still, we may forget that God was there before our arrival. Go in peace.